This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book, Work of Art by Sinclair Lewis. Chapter 1. The flat roof of the American House, the most spacious and important hotel in Black Thread Center, Connecticut, was lined with sheets of red-painted tin, each embossed with Phoenix, the Tin of Kings. Though it was only 6.02, this July morning in 1897, the roof was scorching. The tin was like a flat iron, and the tar along the brick coping, which had bubbled all yesterday afternoon, was stinging to the fingers. Far below in Putnam Street, a whole three stories down from the red tin roof, Tad Smith, the constable, said to Mr. Barstow, the furniture dealer, "Well, sir, going to be another scorcher, like yesterday." Mr. Barstow thought it over. "Don't know but what you're right. Regular scorcher." "Yes, sir, a scorcher," ruminated Tad, and went his ways chapter never again, perhaps, to appear in history. But on the red tin roof above these burghers, a young poet was dancing, child of the skies, rejoicing in youth and mourning and his newfound power of song. He was alone, except for Lancelot, the hotel dog, and unashamed he saluted the sun god who was his brother. Whistling, "There'll be a hot time in the old town tonight," he strode up and down, his hands swinging as though he were leading a military band, his feet making little intricate patterns, his whole body lurching, his head bobbing from one side to the other in the exhilaration of youth and his own genius. Lancelot barked in appreciation, chapter the first, this, of the applause the master was some day to know. The young poet was named, not very romantically, or a Weagle, but he had read a good deal of Swinburne, Longfellow, Tennyson, and Kipling. He was 15 years old, and already he perceived that he belonged to a world greater than Black Thread Center. In fact, he despised Black Thread, and in particular all manner of things associated with the American House, as owned by his father, old Tom Weagle. The recollection of the fabulous poem he had written last evening turned Aura's fawn-like effervescence to awe, and while Lancelot looked disappointed and settled down to scratching and slumber, he began to croon, then to murmur, then to shout chapter Aura, the young Keats rejoicing in his masterpiece, aloft between Phoenix roofing and the sky. "Cold are thine eyes and the flanks of the hands of thee. Cold as crushed snow on Connecticut hills. But lo, I will break and dissever the bands of thee. Till with blown flame thee the power of me fills. See, I am proud, I am potent and terrible. Dust of the highway I tread in my scorn. Thou unto me art a field that is arable. In sun-soaring splendor thy soul shall be born." "Gee, I don't know where I get it," he whispered. The booming glory exalted him, and he paraded again, tossing his arms and chanting, "Proud, I am proud." Chapter 1M. Chapter, potent and terrible. Chapter, potent and terrible. Listen. I'm proud. Chapter and. Chapter, potent and terrible. Chapter, terrible, terrible, proud. And the sun god showered him with rays, which clothed him in double glory as they were reflected from the red tin roof. The whistle of the 6.07 train from the Berkshires reduced Aura from cloud treader, bright with morning fire, to kindling splitter for the American House. Though he still murmured, "potent and terrible," he was drawn to look over the coping at the actualities of provincial life. Up from the station of the New York, New Haven, and Hartford walked a typical, an unavoidable, a cosmic traveling salesman carrying his two grips. Below Aura, abysmal depths below, his brother, Myron Weagle, was watering the sidewalk with a despicable battered green can. Aura watched this tedious daily comedy with amused eyes. His generosity toward Myron was as much a part of his poet's sovereignty as fire and potency and terribleness. Poor Myron. Myron had, Aura meditated, no imagination, no passion, no ambition, no consciousness of beauty, no desire to be creative or to do anything but keep busy with the trivial daily jobs that seemed to satisfy him. Though Myron was theoretically 2 years older, chapter 17, chapter Aura, felt himself a generation older and more worldly. Even physically you could see the difference. Aura so slim, quick, dark, with fine hair black like black glass, Myron then tall and lumbering with big red hands and an absurd natural pompadour of rope-colored hair. Often Aura had thought that he himself was like a cat, chapter sinuous, swift, independent, while Myron was the perfect dog, and no greyhound or Scotty, but a farm dog, chapter clumsy, contemptibly good-natured, loyal to any insignificant master. Well, the poor devil, thought Aura. He'll probably be happier in his hick way than I will. I'm going to New York. I'm going to make me some perfect work of art. Golly, I bet I suffer like all get out, like insentimental Tommy and David Copperfield, while he sticks here and scratches himself in the sun, chapter like you, Lancelot. Aura watched his dull big brother clumping down the street to welcome the traveling salesman and take his bags. Like a servant. Aura sighed. Come on, Lancelot, we gotta go down and get a little breakfast, he commanded. But before Aura left the coping, he looked distastefully over Black Thread Center and found nothing there. From the roof of the American House, towering as it did a whole story above any other building in town, he could view the microcosm of the village. There were people, reflected Aura, to whom Black Thread Center and East Black Thread made up the hub of the universe, from which you measured distances to Rome and Shanghai and Tierra del Fuego, people to whom a train or a circus or a religion was important as it did or did not touch Black Thread. Aura marveled at their provinciality. For him, chapter O, New York, London, Paris, Berlin, Monte Carlo. He regarded with disfavor the red brick village, Cal Biggis's store, chapter clocks, watches, jewelry, bicycles, chapter beside the hotel. Barstow's Furniture Emporium, undertaking in all its branches across the street. The frame station of the NY, NH and Hartford with its greasy platform. The village square, and the gray cast iron statue of a Civil War soldier. He could, it is true, see the light-flecked Housatonic River across the tracks, and on the other side of town a hill thick with elm and maple and spruce. But even so, just sort of ordinary country. Nothing historical. No castles. Ah. Come on you, Lancelot, said Aura. He thumbed his nose at the stolid Myron carrying the traveling man's bags and skipped to the trapdoor singing, potent and terrible. He paused to muse, nothing romantic. Not a doggone thing. What a name for a town. Black Thread Center. The Reverend Thaddeus Prout of Beulah, Connecticut, had Sunday after Sunday, through 1637, warned his complacent people that they must guard the hill gap to the north and east against the Indians. I preach unto you eternal mercy, and I also preach unto you eternal vigilance, roared the old pastor in the high pulpit of the church. I preach to you the incessant practice of prayer and the incessant practice of musketry as I learned it in His Majesty's own right and Royal Worcestershire's. I tell you that this hill gap is a black threat, a black threat. A black threat to our peace and well-being. He said it so often that his parishioners began jestingly to call the settlement north and east of them, a settlement of one log tavern and store and four cabins, the black threat. They jested too warmly and too soon. When the Indians did tiptoe through the gap and circle Beulah, the settlers fought with axe and rifle, led by the Reverend Thaddeus with a saber belt round his broadcloth and his white beard smeared with blood, but the goodly village was almost wiped out. Thereafter, the settlement beyond them was called Black Threat, with more anxious reverence. It was a young government surveyor who put the name down as Black Thread in 1810, considering in his Harvard manner the probabilities of spellings and the idiocy of myths. Of all this Aura had never heard chapter, nor anyone else, perhaps, in Black Thread Center in 1897. Followed by a subdued Lancelot, the subdued kin of the sun god crept down the ladder from the roof into the hotel, into narrow hallways carpeted with straw matting worn in channels like footpaths, into the enveloping smell of cheap pink soap and cabbage and sweaty clothes and old cotton sheets. The American house had 34 bedrooms, 29 singles and 5 doubles. It was, the Weagles considered, a vigorously modern hotel, It had gas instead of kerosene lamps, and in the office was a telephone, in a long dark box like an upended coffin. Each of the single rooms, Chapter Aura could see them as he passed open doors. Chapter contained one wooden bed, the varnish a little cracked, one straight chair, one strip of carpet beside the bed, lace curtains very dingy, a gas light in so crafty a position on the wall that it neither illuminated the mirror nor enabled the guest to read in bed, one washstand with pitcher and bowl, painted with lilacs or a snow scene, a slop jar standing on a strip of linoleum not very successfully imitating marble with white oilcloth tacked on the wall. Behind it, one cake of streaky soap, one thin towel, and a concentration of the prevailing smell. But the double rooms were more elaborate. They added an extra towel, an extra straight chair, a table, and usually a calendar on the wall. The mattresses on the beds were lumpy and sagging in the middle. The sheets were coarse, scratchy cotton, Chapter, though, with Edna Weagle, Mrs. Tom Weagle, as housekeeper, they were immaculate and free of the bedbug. Edna spoke often and bitterly of bedbugs and pursued them daily. The blankets were of cotton, and the comforters filled with cotton batting. They were very heavy and not warm. On winter nights, experienced traveling salesmen laid their overcoats on top them. Though he was so used to the hotel, his home these years, that he rarely saw it, today Aura was so heightened by poetic triumph that for 10 seconds he did stop to look into number 20. "What a hole," he sighed. "Sometime I'll have a room with a great big leather chair and a bed with silk sheets. Maybe black." He was too black thread center, too 1897, to admit that he was considering how voluptuous his slimness, the fine whiteness of his body, would seem against black silk sheets. In the hall he met Flossie Gitz, the second maid. Now Aura was 15 and Flossie was 20, but she was generous and without prejudice. She had ringlets and what was then known as a bust. She dallied happily with any male from the age of 10 to 100, though she preferred a ripe traveling man of 35, who wore a Masonic ring and was willing to hire a livery stable rig to give a girl a good time. "Say, listen, Aura, Myron is sore as a boil you ain't cleaned the basement and the sample rooms," said Flossie. "The hell with him," said Aura. "Yay, but what he'll do to you. Ah, give us a kiss. You behave yourself now. Oh. Why, Aura Weagle, you ought to be ashamed yourself, acting like that. I am potent and terrible. Gee, I bet you swallowed the dictionary, Chapter, all them words. Listen, Aura, I'll help you clean the basement, soon's I do number 23 and 15. All right, sweetie." Aura swaggered down to the office. He did swagger. For all his conquests among the village girls of his own age, this was his first triumph as a gigolo, a young gallant cajoling an older woman. The walls of the office were lined with cane rockers, alternating with brass spittoons. The desk was of grained pine. Back of it hung the room keys, attached to chunks of wood so that they might not be carried off, and on it were a pen stuck in a potato and a register swung on a brass swivel. The register was always open, of course, for hotel men of that period knew nothing else so certainly as that, if the register was ever closed, you would get no more business that day. There was no one in the office. Aura was relieved not to see Myron. Perhaps after carrying the traveling man's grips to his room, he had hustled out for early morning shopping. Chapter, old Tom was supposed to do all the buying, but he often slept late, almost till 7, and Myron was simpleton enough to be willing to run out for an extra pound of bacon in case of a breakfast rush. Aura felt free again. He slipped through the dining room and billiard room to the bar. If Jock McCready, the regular bartender, was on, he would be able to coax a tiny glass of beer before breakfast. But when Aura opened the door into that haven, with its cool smell of beer, magnificent mahogany bar, delicate pyramids of glassware, and that greatest painting Aura had ever seen, Chapter, a nude lady, lying among cushions scarlet and saffron and emerald, Chapter, he hesitated, for it was Myron who stood behind the bar, with an ebony slicer removing the excess foam from a glass of beer for the first morning customer. "Hey, you come here," thundered Myron. "What's eating you?" whimpered the sun god's heir. He edged in, irritably facing Myron's sergeant major eye. Seen close, Myron's tow-colored exuberance of hair was stiff, as though his scalp had some extra vitality. His strong skin was of the Norse snow-fed pallor that no sun ever tanned, no adolescence ever blotched. Myron had, Aura sometimes admitted, a certain broad-shouldered power and health in him, chapter, if he could only have Aura's imagination, instead of being a mere human broom standing up ended. "Aura, you haven't swept the balconies for 2 days. You didn't have any kindling when I started the range this morning, and the woodbox about half full. And the basement chapter here's a traveling man just come in this morning, wants a sample room right away and both of 'em dirty." Feeling safe, across the bar, Aura jeered, "What are you going to do about it?" Through the air flew a tiger. Myron had stepped on a beer keg and vaulted the bar. He was shaking Aura like a kitten. "I'll wail the everlasting daylights out of you, that's what I'll do. I'm sick and tired of your loafing. The only person around this hotel that never does any work. Do you clean the sample rooms and so on and so forth right now, or do I lick you?" "All right. All right. Gosh. Gee whiz. You don't have to act like a hyena. With you I do. Now get. I'll let you have breakfast first, and then." Aura, already at the door, popped his small head in to retort, "You'll let me have breakfast. It ain't yours to let. I guess it belongs to Pa and Ma." But he retreated with speed. He knew these lickings by Myron, rare but extraordinarily painful and lasting. Alice Agerty, the bulky colleague of Flossie Gitz, was serving breakfast. Standing between two traveling men, she was chanting, "Oatmeal, choik of eggs, bacon, ham, steak chops, sausage, wee cakes." Aura himself breakfasted poetically on oatmeal, pork chop with an egg, wheat cakes, bacon, coffee, and just a nibble or two of Johnny cake and toast smeared with plum jam. The coffee was weak, with grounds floating on it. The butter was artificially colored, and as it had come out of a tub preserved with salt, there were salt crystals apparent on the brilliantly yellow pat. With the chop, which had been fried in lard, there were last night's potatoes warmed up. If Aura's delicacy and vision were offended by this coarse plenty, there were no signs of it, as he wolfed it down. He ate at the family table, behind the two long ones for the public. The dining room had green wallpaper with yellow roses, bare floor, and for splendor, an enormous black walnut buffet, adorned with silver cruet stands and fruit and nut bowls of imitation cut glass chapter thriftily empty save at Sunday noon. Beside the double door, on a small table with a decorous white linen cover, was a large bowl of toothpicks. The cloths of the long tables were clean, but that of the Weigel family table was somewhat geographic, with its islands of egg yolk, catsup, gravy, and butter. While Aura was breakfasting, his father joined him. Tom Weigel had a corded brown neck, which his watery beard did not quite conceal. He wore steel-rimmed spectacles crookedly, and behind them his expression was wistful and rather vague. His nose was red. Though he seemed frail, he had the leathery hands of a farmer. "Morning," said old Tom. "Morning," said Aura. "Did you sweep the basement, like you was told?"
"Sure."
"Well." That seemed to cover the subject. Tom, after ordering oatmeal, steak, fried eggs, and a double order of wheats, chapter all of which would vanish without evident effect into his meager corporation chapter, was silent. He was long-winded enough with traveling men, in the narration of anecdotes about old days on the farm, the wickedness of guests who did not pay, servants who did not work, and the wonders of his one trip to New York, but with his family he saw no gain in wasting wit. They chewed opposite each other, Tom looking vague, Aura looking sleepy. But Aura was meditating like a quiescent volcano. "That big brute, Myron. Didn't know any way of trying to deal with a slick brain like his brother's, except by threatening to lick him. And such stinking melodrama chapter vaulting the bar, like that big, fat, ridiculous hero in the melodrama that played here under canvas last week, Barry O'Leary's own company in Bonnets O'Dundee. Myron wouldn't even know the meaning of the word melodrama. Huh. You. Sure. No brains, no education. Could Myron make a line like, "Till with blown flame thee the power of me fills?" He could not. Aura felt better, much better. He was damped a little by the spectacle of a fat, moist forefinger beckoning from the door to the kitchen. The white paint of the door was worn in a blotch halfway up by the hips of urgent waitresses pushing out with trays of dirty dishes. It was the finger of a lady who had the honor of being not only cook of the American house but also mother of Aura Weigel, chapter Edna Weigel, who combined the seemly plumpness of a cook with the worried intensity of the wife of a drunkard. Aura slowly forsook blown flame and potency and terror. He scooped up the last sweetness of syrup and crumbs of wheat cake with a spoon, while Alice Agerty, the waitress, scowled at him. To think of that darn boy using up a whole spoon, and it would have to be washed now for just one mouthful. Aura sauntered gracefully into the heat and the smell of frying grease in the kitchen. "What do you want, Ma?" he complained. "Your pa has got to drive over to Beulah this morning, about some chickens, and we're short of lard, and I want you should go to Aldgate sometime this morning and get a pail of it. Gosh, I gotta do everything around this hotel, chapter clean the basement, and sweep the balconies and fill the wood box and everything." "Yes, it's too bad about you." Edna Weigel scoffed, and wiped her hands on the not very clean apron round the plumpness of her gingham-covered middle. "I've only been working since 5. You get that lard, or I'll have Myron. 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 Ain't I ever going to hear anything all my life but Myron. Me highest stand in the whole sophomore class, and him way down near the foot in the senior." "Yes, baby, I know. Yes. I guess that's right. Maybe you ain't suited to this kind of work, like Myron is. I do believe and hope that someday you'll be a dentist, or a lawyer, or even a preacher. There." She stroked his hair, chapter which Aura hated because she smelled of soft yellow soap and donut fat. "You just go ahead reading and studying and all. But you won't forget my lard, will you?" "No, sure not." Recognized for the pundit he was, Aura swaggered upstairs to find the fair, fond Flossie Gitz and to persuade her to help him sweep the inevitable basement. She grumbled a little at having to leave a bed half-made, but she came, and the sample rooms and the furnace room were cleaned and made beautiful. It was a satisfactory division of labor. Aura talked and Flossie worked. She swept, dusted, and nailed down a loose board on one of the long tables which, set across trestles in the sample room, would presently bloom in unblack thread-like splendors of the Orient, with silk Scotch plaid blouses, elegant O'Brand leather belts in 2 colors, dainty dot veils, gauntlet gloves. In fact, with all the choicest wares of M&I Volschitz's Ladies' Wear Company of New York, Cincinnati, and Kansas City, for the inspection of the ardent merchants of Black Thread Center chapter this modern Oriental market, where the vendors did not squat about fires of camel's dung, but in check suits, smoking cigars, standing upright with the freedom and efficiency of 1897 in America, chose beauty with an eye to profit. "You've done it pretty good, Flossie. Come here and kiss me," said Aura. "Bye. See you later." He left her chapter somewhat perplexed, as later many ladies were to be, as to whether she had done too much or too little chapter, and galloping up the stairs he swung through the alley behind the American house to Putnam Street, slinkingly followed by Lancelot. He had a moment's shudder at the greasy garbage in the alley, the debris of hotels, and the whole frowsiness of communal living, but he forgot it in the clean hot sun of the street, and Lancelot, again convinced that he was the dog of a sun god and not the dog of an hotel, chased an imaginary cat, and after it barked, potent and terrible. It must be stated that Lancelot was so named only by Aura. To the rest of the hotel personnel he was spot or merely get out of that. Not once, all day, did Aura remember the lard for his mother. After all, There was a story, once much read, about Mary and Martha. And it was Aura's vacation time. It was summer, and beyond Black Thread Center up on Elm Hill, there were things more worth the inquiry of a young poet than lard and the state of a sample room for the traveling representative of M&I Volschitz. End of the chapter. Chapter 2. Up to the little groves and hollows, to the peace and freedom of Elm Hill, pounded a young poet and his dog. But they stopped a moment at the garden of the man who had taught Aura that much existed in this world besides the lilies and Sunday morning languors, the roses and strictly respectable raptures of Connecticut. This was the Reverend Waldo Ivy, the Episcopal pastor. Despite his name, Mr. Ivy was round, red, and breathless. He loved liturgy, tradition, cleanliness, and poetry. Black Thread thought him queer. In 10 years in this church, he had found precisely one soul who understood his gospel, that beauty is truth, truth beauty, and that was Aura Weigle. He loved to be called, and never save by one was called Padre. Again, that one was Aura. Aura had probably got it from Kipling. He had taught Aura everything he knew, chapter, provided Aura did know anything. In high school, in which he was to be a junior this coming fall, Aura had learned that the ways and finalities of literature are thus, in the far past chapter ever so long ago, even before the American Revolution chapter, there were good writers. Quite good. There was a gentleman named Caesar, who went to England and Americanized the natives. There was Cicero, who objected to a man named Catiline, and so killed all gangsterdom forever. There was Virgil, who was somehow very beautiful. And chapter, though these were actually read only in swell schools like Andover chapter, there were Greeks, like Homer and Sophocles and Aeschylus, who were pretty important. Then the history of literature skipped a long while, chapter 200 or maybe 2,000 years chapter, and you came to Jane Austen, Dickens, Thackeray, Scott, Tennyson, Longfellow, Whittier, Walt Whitman, and Poe. These authors were all dead. In fact, the age of literature was dead, like the age of chivalry, though there were some pretty good hack writers living now, chapter William Dean Howells and Mark Twain and a Frenchman named Anatole France. But the Reverend Waldo Ivy had told Aura that literature was only beginning, that the world's struggle for beauty and justice had never been so glorious as now. The boy's eyes lightened, his breathing grew rapid, as Mr. Ivy testified to his gospel. And in that little Episcopal study, smelling of the leather bindings of old Greek books and the buckram of new novels, Mr. Ivy at last trusted one disciple and read to him. Till the slow sea rise and the sheer cliff crumble. Till terrace and meadow the deep gulfs drink. Till the strength of the waves of the high tides humble. The fields that lessen, the rocks that shrink. Hear now in his triumphs where all things falter. Stretched out on the spoils that his own hand spread. As a god self-slain on his own strange altar. Death lies dead. It was such a little study, Mr. Ivy's, just behind the church, a plaster room looking on a garden 7 feet square, with a cement walk which he called his ambulatory. There were stiff crocuses and timid pansies in the garden. On the walls of the study were pictures of S. Paolo Fori Le Murray, of Thoreau and Emerson. The priest, after he had read Swinburne, looked at Aura diffidently and said, "There is a greater poetry than all of this. It's from the Bible. I wonder if you know it. You see, my dear boy, the fathers of my church knew so long ago all that afflicts us now. Would you like to hear it?" "Sure," said Aura. "This is perhaps the greatest poetry that has ever been written. Listen, my son. Or ever the silver cord be loosed, or the golden bowl be broken, or the pitcher be broken at the fountain, or the wheel broken at the cistern. Then shall the dust return to the earth as it was, and the spirit shall return unto God who gave it. Vanity of vanities, saith the preacher, all is vanity." Mr. Ivy looked up, over the eyeglasses that creased his red face. The boy was weeping. "I didn't know," he sobbed, "that the Bible was poetry. I thought it was nothing but religion. but that had been 2 years ago. This July morning, when Aura condescendingly nodded to Mr. Ivy over the fence, he was not awed. For he himself was a poet now, with no need for reverence for the old stiff.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.